My Lord, come. Humble yourselves. he will beat you for dessert. Shut-ty-do, keep the devil in the night. Shut-ty-do, keep out the devil. Shut-ty-do, keep the devil in the night. Shut-ty-do, keep out the devil. Light a candle, everything's all right. Light a candle, everything's all right, sir. Hey, 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 shut-ty-do. Hey, 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 shut out the devil. Hey, hey, hey.
Someone's loving.
Someone's loving.
those who want to change.
Charles Bridge, so it will be, I think, a beautiful sight.
Hallmark card.
Mike has a camera. I'll give him a hug when he puts on the camera.
It's a big.
La, 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 la.
Keep the devil in the night.
Shut-dee-do, keep out the devil.
He's hungry for a soul to hurt.
Shut-dee-do, keep the devil in the night.
And without
your holy armor.
Shut-dee-do, keep out the devil.
He will eat you for dessert.
Shut-dee-do, keep the devil in the night. Shut-dee-do, keep out the devil. Shut-dee-do, keep the devil in the night. Shut-dee-do, keep out the devil. Light the candle. Keep in the
I can think of no more appropriate time, perhaps, than at the moment, to speak more personally about my appreciation for the chaperones. Obviously, the trip would not be complete without them. And as a little token of my appreciation, I have a gift for each of them. You know, most of our chaperones I know, except Sharon, who was a recent acquaintance. I think we've all gotten to know each other in a different way than we know each other at home. It's unfortunate that what we experience here, we can't really share with friends and relatives and parents at home. We can tell them about it, but they can't really know the flavor. You sort of have to be here to know what's going on. Sharon, like you. We'll talk about appreciation, and we'll come and visit your restaurant for the year. Now, this next young lady bears a special description. I called my contacts at Scotland Yard, and they were not able to send a representative down here to give a special award to this lady, so she's the one that saved my worldly belongings. Eiffel Tower, with a quick action, based on her training at Scotland Yard. Scotland Yard, she was able to give him a swift karate chop and send him on his way. So, our Scotland Yard award goes to Elvina, and my appreciation. Delicious meals each day. By the time we'd gotten off the bus, he'd already located the finest Italian restaurant for us to have lunch.
And gyros!
And even though I was equipped with an emergency bag of food my wife had given me, I decided to sort of not use that quite often and spend my time with the fine restaurants that Scotty had found for us. My appreciation, Scotty. Many talents. I've known him for several years. Gary, I've known for many years at Westhill High School. Got to know him better in the last couple of years, especially this last year as I sought to change my personality. He was one of my consultants at the school to check and see if I was making some progress. He will be at the school next year, obviously, so part of the spirit still carries on as far as some of the staff. Candy has been a treasure during this year, and together they've been quite a lovable, supportive team for us. My appreciation. Yeah. An excellent lady has been supportive in many ways, as you saw tonight with her musical talents, and unbeknownst to many of her many times when I've had to call upon someone at the very last moment, I do mean the last moment, to either drive or to cover something in terms of rehearsal. Either she or her husband has been there to support you and the choir. So my word of appreciation for Gretchen for being here and for support all during the course of the year. Weeks. One I knew on the phone only for many, many months, and finally got to find the face that fits the voice. And you'll hear her voice tonight. She's a fine singer. So what a so she won't forget us. We'd like to give her one of our Westhill t-shirts. I hope that your memories will go along with it. To the young lady, so they kept us on track momentarily or a long range, and you never know quite what language she has to speak in the moment. We saw what a problem may happen. We're going to see both her and the driver tomorrow before this evening. I'd like to have her share one of our t-shirts also, Monique. I know some of you have some things you want to do right now, so let's take a moment to address that. Okay, the next item is
conducting.
many countless thoughts I've had. One of my own things right now is the fact that I think there's no more gracious or glorious way to end a part of your career than I have had in these past 2 weeks. Many of my colleagues left Westhill High School, and I feel I've had an even greater chance to enjoy leaving because of your involvement in the last 2 weeks. And I thank you for that. It's been very, very, very memorable. The sounds of your laughter, the sounds of your songs will linger for many, many years, believe me. And they only seek to enhance my ability and feelings to go into all the rest of my career, my life, and so forth. So I thank you for that.
You're welcome.
These last 2.5 weeks, I've cried the most I know in the last 2.5 weeks, and I think I've been very happy. And so I just want to thank everybody for that.
I'd also like to thank our videographer Mike for getting everything on tape, all the crimes, all the laughter, all the singing, so that we'll be able to remember that.
Explain to you what I've been through. You have to be through it. And I'm glad that I was with the people that I was with. So.
Sharon and Wesley for always putting a smile on my face. Laura, Bill, Maureen, my surrogate mothers, always taking care of me. Aaron, always keeping me on my toes. Stephanie, always making me and remembering. Heavy. Miss Callion, thanks for the belly rubs. And Mr. Robinson, thanks for the frequent kisses.
Doubtful that we were as good of a choir as the other choirs. We've heard all these incredible stories about, like, singing for Mother Teresa and crying, and that we were at that level. But, like, even the first performance here at Luxembourg Gardens, where we had an encore in our first performance, and then especially last night, where people were surprised that we didn't have tapes and that we didn't want money, that really, like, shocked me. And I realized how good we were. That, like, even people who don't understand our language were so grateful that we were singing. And I wanted to thank Mr. Chapman for that.
I'd like to thank Oliver Craig and Ryan for their use of the balcony for the of my water.
I'd also like to thank Will, because I think he's come an incredibly long way. And through his tough journey, he's inspired me to keep on just stroking on and moving. And I think he's really something.
Thanks, Will. On that note, I'd like to say something. I want to thank you all of you, for Mr. Chapman, especially. For having faith in me, especially Mr. Chapman, because I've talked to Mr. Chapman many times. I went through a lot of family problems this year. They're not over yet, but I think because of a lot of the support that I felt from you guys and Mr. Chapman, from my father and my family, I've been able to get through it, and I'll be able to survive it. So I want to just thank you all.
Well, first of all, I just want to forewarn you that I'm going to give every one of you at least one hug before we leave, so watch out if you don't like me or if you don't want it, because too bad. And and second of all, I wanted to give a special thanks to Mallory, because she's really stood by me this year, and it was a very difficult and trying year for me. Personally, you know, my personal life, my schedule, my everything, and she really supported me and helped me and went above and beyond the duty of vice president, and she also was my friend, and I appreciate that.
I'd like to say thank you to my two bodyguards and roommates, away fathers, Will and Wes, for keeping me in line and keeping certain people from beating me up in the room.
We never grounded. I don't know where you came up with that. We never, ever grounded.
That was Wes. Wes told us.
You put him on punishment.
You're welcome.
I'd like to thank Rachel, Amy, and Carol for use of their room. So many times.
It was so huge.
But not.
for sleeping because no one violated bed check.
I'd like to thank everyone for giving me the opportunity to videotape everyone. I mean, it was sort of a surprise when one day Mr. Palmer, the TV production teacher, just came up to me and asked me after I had finished taping the basketball games if I'd like to go to Europe, you know? And so I ran out and got my passport and off I was to Europe, and it was this is probably one of the best summers I've ever had, and hopefully the tape will come out good. And
otherwise, you die.
And for your sake, it better.
Better. And I think really you guys really put a lot of hard work into it. It really shows on the tape, and it was really excellent. And I'd just like to thank you for that.
Freshman year, I asked Barry Newport what chamber singers was like, because I wasn't sure if I wanted to try out or not.
she said to me, it's not something you can explain. It's not just a choir. It's something that is a part of you, and it becomes a part of you. And I kind of looked at her and said, yeah, right, whatever. And this tour, like, she said to me, you know, these are some of the people that you will love most in your life, and they're some of the people that you will want to kill most in your life at the same time. And she was so right. this choir it became important to, like, I guess it's because we rehearse so much. Like, you're there all the time, so it has to become important. It became really important to me.
At least it should be there, right?
And the people in the choir became really important to me, and I think that's part of the reason the music is so good. Not because of how hard we rehearse or how hard we work between rehearsals, but because we all feel kind of a bond because we spend so much time together. And you guys have become really important to me, and I'll miss you a whole lot next year. And I just wanted to say that.
I'm late,
man. I'm late.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's 6 people.
I'm late. There's 6 people.
I'd like to thank Valerie for all of her hours of dedication to being bass section leader and the hard work.
Chauffeur.
No. this year, because she really did an extraordinary job in teaching us our music and whatnot.
For hours.
So thank you. For hours.
And I'd like to thank our section leader for our whopping 3 or 4 sectionals. We made us the section rework.
Yeah, we found the longest sectionals in history.
I just want to say something about that. Those 3 or 4 sectionals, they did affect everything that happened. I mean, those 4 hours that took us for each sectional to get through, like,
once
2 or 3 people.
Measures.
It was very trying, but I want to thank all of her for helping me throughout the year. I mean, I know I've improved, I've seen improvement throughout the whole section, throughout the whole choir, and Oliver was going to help no matter what the problem was, and that's my thank you for that.
Thanks, Oliver.
I know lots of people in the choir got mad when Mr. Chapman always said, good job, alto, because we did so great. Alto's the best,
He was just sucking up to that.
That's all because of Beth. Because we did have lots of sectionals. Like every single week, okay, you have to have a sectional this week, da da da. Like, she kept us on our toes, and when we actually got there to have the sectionals, like, we'd all start talking and laughing and stuff, and she'd, come on, we have to do this. And she's the whole reason why we were the best.
I would like to thank Mr. Stanek on behalf of William, Laura, Craig, Aaron, and
Mike.
Mr. Television Man. thank you for being our chaperone and for watching over us and losing us. thank you.
And we would like to re-present you.
Thank you very much. They gave me this earlier at the restaurant. I was really touched. And I thank them very much sincerely then. And it's a wonderful keepsake. It's dedicated to freedom in Czechoslovakia.
No, the 50th anniversary of
U-Day. 1945 to 1995. It's fantastic. I'm really appreciative. Thank you.
Um,
person that sticks out of all of them. And to tell the truth, we spent time together, but we really didn't spend a lot of time together. And because I was never home, and stuff like that. And, except for the week before tour when I was grounded on home. But, I wasn't going to test that because you guys are blind.
You know, Wesley, now down the stairs, man.
I really have to say, I love you, big mama. Being in this choir has brought that passion that streams from within your soul and down your arms, through your legs to the fingertips. And it's just the passion, and I feel it when I'm walking with Will and when I'm talking with Wesley. I feel the passion when I look at Mr. Chapman and the wonder that he's created. I see it when I look at Beth and her smiles. I see it when I see Ryan and his magic. I see it when I look at the smiles, and it's just passion and love, and that's the most important thing. And music really does transcend everything. It's the innermost part of us. It's our humanness. It's what keeps us going. And I'd like to thank Mr. Chapman for putting me intact with that inner passion.
I hate to break in like this, but according to my watch, it's after 12 o'clock.
Hey, Mallory.
Happy birthday to you.
Try that.
Yeah, Mallory!
Your names before I saw your faces to go with them.
some of your names I knew wrong, but we had to straighten that out. But I just want you to know that working with Mr. Chapman has been such a joy to me. And then when I came and met all of you and heard you sing that first time, music is, to me as it is to Laura Phil, it fills my soul. I belong to a choir myself of 100 voices, and I love it. Music to me is as much a part of my life as breathing. And so when I'm able to travel with a choir that has the quality that you guys have in your singing, it's been a great joy to me to listen to you sing. And I have you on tape over and over as you've done your performances, and we'll go back and cherish this. And it's not every choir I feel that about. But you guys are special, you are. And you're special because you have a great leader who has brought everything out of you that he has. And you can be good because he knows how to help you bring out the very best of yourselves. And I thank him for the opportunity that I've had to get acquainted with him and to know each one of you. And I think it's the first time ever that I've known each person by name and been able to call you by name. I have a real hard time with names. And I felt a real kinship as I came into this choir. And I appreciate the 2 weeks I've been with you. I really do.
Thank you.
I'd just like to say something. I transferred schools this year, as most of you know. So Westhill was the opportunity, and I changed because I wanted to be in an environment and with people who were more human, who had tolerance for difference and respect for there's a lot that I want to say to you all. What I found was the first day that I came into the choir, I found it there. I found it when I spoke to Mr. Chapman the day before school began. Because I was sitting there, and I was marveling at the fact that this man was a philosopher. And I couldn't believe that. And we sat there for like 4 hours and spoke of everything. And I was really fascinated by him and his ideas, and his depth of person. And then I just found it in all of you. And I really want to say thank you, because I've learned so much from each of you. I can't really tell you how much I've learned. But I was sitting this year a lot by myself in my home, and I was thinking about you all. And I wrote a poem about myself. And in one particular part, I expressed the emotions that music and this whole experience has many moments delivered me up to a higher level. I said delivered me up to God and angels and what I think is like the elemental life, the essence of living. And I found that a lot on this tour as well, when we sang in different places. And I just want to say thank you, because I'm leaving, and I won't really be seeing many of you again for a while. And that really makes me really sad. But I just wanted to say thank you, because you don't know how much this has really changed.
I want to thank all of you just one more time, especially Will, Oliver, Aaron, Mallory, all of you again, because yesterday when you sang on Danny Boy, glad I would have done if I was back in the States. I might have lost it. But you guys kept me together. You made me see what was important right now. And there was something I had to do, and I had to sing. And I sang for him that last concert. And personally, it was the most moving thing I've ever done. And I just want to thank all of you, and I'd like to thank you, Mr. China, for putting him in after your first concert. Thank you.
I want to say thank you especially to my roommates, Allison, Sarah, and Kate. Me and Allison have been friends for a while, actually best friends, and we thought we were going to get sick of each other, being with each other every single day, every single moment, and so far we haven't had a fight yet, and we've gotten along really well. Sorry, I'm really superstitious. I've had a great time on this tour, and I'm really glad that I joined the choir. I wasn't going to join the choir this year because I had so many things going on and I didn't think I'd have time for it. But when I was involved in the choir, even though it took up tons of time, it seemed to be worth it, and it was worth it. And I had a fabulous time on this tour. I've experienced things that I don't think I'll ever experience again. And I just want to say thank you also for all my names that I've gotten on this tour.
Jerusalem.
Royals.
And I want to tell Kate thank you for saving me and being with me in the train station.
Oh, thank you.
And I also want to say thank you to Will. Me and Will were friends really before the tour. We hardly ever talked. He was in my math class and I don't think I ever said one word to him. And I want to say thank you to him for being such a great friend and saving me from all these scuzzy guys. Tell Allison never to forget the professor. Thank you.
Ronan, you didn't win. Here's a consolation prize.
Thank you.
Jared, you didn't win.
No kidding.
But here's consolation prize.
I'm on it, really.
I did that. This one doesn't have a name on it. Beth,
yeah.
Is that you?
It's okay.
Where does it say Beth? Oh, on. You didn't win either, but here's a consolation prize.
Oh, thanks.
Rachel, you got it. So, blue ribbon. And the answer to the answer to the mystery is that it was Maureen. Because she was upset with Mr. Tucci, because he didn't release her transcripts in time for her to get into the school of her choice.
She's a junior.
Right, but she's transferring schools.
Oh.
And if everybody had compared notes, that was in there.
And we had a retirement party.
Great party.
And we went, the pebbles left.
Free food.
And we sang a song.
5 weeks ago, his name is George Weigel. I don't expect anyone here would know him. He was a former choral director at Staples High School in Westport. George retired from his job 10, 12, 15 minutes ago, perhaps. and he was a mentor of mine when I first started teaching at Greenwich High School. And I remember on one occasion, I had just been elected to some state office or something, and I wasn't too sure what to do, so I called George about 9:30 at night and said, George, I have a problem. I'm responsible for something as division president here in Connecticut. And within 20 minutes, George was knocking on my door. He drove down from Westport and spent a couple hours helping me. Time when I got to know George very well as my choir developed, and we occasionally did a few joint concerts together with Westport singers. And we were attending an All-State Festival once, and we were sort of sitting there waiting for the evening concert to start. And several of our colleagues were retiring, and at that time, retirement seemed so strange to me. I couldn't imagine. The word didn't mean anything to me. And so George said, you know, you have to make sure you retire whenever that comes in your life, to retire at a time when your immediate environment's very happy and things are going well and you're doing very, very happy things with your students and so forth. And I sort of heard that, didn't hear it. Then about a month ago, as I said, George wrote me this letter. Somehow you heard that I had made this very quick decision to retire about 6 weeks ago. And he wrote me a long, 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 long letter, which I won't go into. But anyway, he showed up at this retirement banquet that the quartet, which the quartet sang. And he said, yeah, you see, you took my advice. And I said, well, what advice is that? He said, know that conversation we had 15 years ago? And it lingered in my mind for a moment. I said, yeah, I guess you're right.
Yeah,
it wasn't until this tour, really, that it really said it, and I think I've said it to one or two people, all the paperwork was in, all that stuff was a fait accompli. But it hadn't really hit me, although 98% of my office is cleaned out and so forth. It didn't really hit me until the tour. And especially last night, I said, gee, it's almost over. And when we sang Kumbaya, something clicked in my mind right then, that a portion of my life had come to a completion. Thousands of memories went through my head of thousands of concerts, literally, over many years, and all the different things that have happened, and also consummated that one moment you're saying Kumbaya. I sort of heard the voices of thousands of singers that we've sung in many places. I'm talking about this choir in particular now, in many different places in the world. They all seem to, for one second, it seemed to have heard 100 concerts all at the same time. Different voices all over the world. And it was a weird sensation. So when I turned around and looked at it, I was sort of vague. I couldn't place myself. Like, there were just too many voices coming at me at the same time. So when I thank you, I guess I'm thanking hundreds of other people that have come before you. And I said to someone when you sang at Normandy, you said, well, we'll never be here again. I have a philosophy, and a friend here is very true. If I could have made a living as a philosopher, that's where I would have been. That when you sang the other day at Dachau, your music is there. It will go on. It's there and other people will experience it. You don't necessarily have to have a concert that's been prepared on a program for you for it to be a sharing. And you had one of those last night that obviously wasn't prepared. At Dachau, that wasn't necessarily a prepared performance. If something happened, I think the things that you did or said will linger. Music is transcendental. It's all around you. It will be shared by many, many, many generations of people. And because of that one factor, we will never be apart, really. I remember sitting in a country club in India with Don Russell, who was many of you probably know, he's a commentator, and he has an article in the Stanford Advocate every night. And he was he wasn't a chaperone, he was just sending back stories every night over the radio to AP. About our concert tour in India and meetings, spending time with Mother Teresa. And one night we were sitting there and we were both sort of crying. We just spent the morning with Mother Teresa and we spent many, many months, probably more months of preparation than ever with the choir because of the great cultural changes going to India. And I said to the choir, you know, we've got to be strong enough so no matter what we see, since what you see in India is more drastic or anything you see on the face of the globe, that we must always maintain our composure and sing. We were about to have a meeting with Mother Teresa in Calcutta, where she lives, and the meeting was at 5:30 in the morning. She starts her day early, so we had to get up and be prepared to be in the courtyard at the convent. And I had never seen her, obviously, before, only pictures of her. When she came down the steps, she's a little tiny lady, and we were going to sing for her at that moment. And we all also a tight lip, you know, this great emotional moment, and she came down the steps. She didn't walk, she sort of glided, it seems, sort of glided down the steps, and all of a sudden she's looking at us, and we started singing. And no matter how hard I tried, I could not stop crying. Every single singing was crying. I don't know how we were saying. There were barrels of tears coming on the face, you know, but they were glorious in terms of the singing. And after singing a couple of times, she looked at me and said, "Why are you crying?" And we didn't really know. And she went on and gave a long, extemporaneous little speech to us about how fortunate we were to be able to travel to other sections of the world and share music. And she emphasized the importance of going back to your own country and doing more sharing and so forth. That night, to go back to where I started, Don Russell and I were sitting in the country club where we were staying, and he said, "You know, why were we crying? You know, sins of omission, what? What do you think it was all about?" And I also had a feeling that came over me that night, and it did with Don at the same moment, that there was a reason why this group of, the choir was so large, that, you know, 32 singers, why that particular group of 32 singers was in India. And I just had that strong feeling for some moment, and he did too, that there would be very, very strong feelings of all those singers throughout the rest of our lives. And that was in 1980, and lo and behold, I'd say 90% of those singers I hear from, we sort of communicate from any place that they happen to be. We just sort of call each other. They'll call just to say hello, hi, or they're thinking about something we'd sung. And it appears that the bond seems to get stronger over the years. And two singers in the choir, Tara and Tracy Miller, that Gary may recall, they were sons and, excuse me, daughters of Mr. Miller, who was the principal. They were in the choir at that time, assistant principal rather, and they were there, and they both looked at me, and the next morning they said, "Wait, it's just been feeling last night. There's a reason why we're here." And I said, "Really?" John Russell and I were saying the same thing the night before. Well, make a long story short, you know, we've had many, many tours, and I had a feeling just last night there's a reason why this particular group of people were here at the time we were. Now, the tour was supposed to have taken place last summer, as you know, and had to be curtailed, and it was within the possible realm of possibility that there wouldn't be a tour this year. That could have been possibly not to have happened. But I just had that strong feeling that there's a reason why all this group of people are where we are at this particular moment. We've had lots of these gatherings at the end of concert tours. They're always sort of fun-filled, but I hear some very profound things going on tonight that do tell me that this group of people physically may not spend too much more time together, but the things that we've felt and shared will linger, and they do grow. And we will see each other, whether it's physically or spiritually, we do grow by the things that we say and the things that we do. It would take me an infinite number of hours to say thank you for all that I get. I hear many plaudits from all of you, but the greatest plaudit needs to come from me for sharing with students. Teaching is a two-way street. It's not, you know, one way. You teach, you learn from the students, obviously, if you have any degree of success at all. And so I have to thank you imminently for that. I will miss you. There'll be lots of joyful kinds of tears. I'm not going to be going. I'm still very active in my career, so I'm still in Stanford, so I hope that you invite me to one of your concerts sometime. I will buy a fair amount of grapefruit, so when it comes, if you're still selling them, grateful. I will still buy a fair amount of those. Someone said the other day, "Why is Kumbaya sung so many times in the benefit concerts?" And some of you may have heard this. Obviously, all of you haven't heard this. Person asked me today. In Poland, 1974, in Poznan, and with a phenomenal choir. It was a choir that year, nine of the kids were going to music school. They're all phenomenal singers, so it was a very unique sound. And we were in this concert hall in Poznan. It was a concert hall for the workers. This is during the days of communism and the before the fall of the Iron Curtain, so things are much different. At the end of the concert, which went on for about an hour and 30 minutes, Luther Blackwell turned and said, "We don't have more encores. What are you going to sing?" And I said, "I don't know." So I quickly said to someone, "What are you going to sing?" So someone said, "Let's sing Kumbaya." Meanwhile, the ushers are stood at the back doors of this auditorium, and blocking the doors. It looked like they didn't want us to leave, but we was a repertoire, and the repertoire was quite long. So we made a circle and sang Kumbaya instead of walking toward the door, but these men sort of stood there just like this. And Luther's a big, learned guy, he's a football player at the time, and he sort of whispered at me, he said, "I'll handle this." I really meant so. I said, "I'll handle it." So he sort of walked over, and as he sang Kumbaya, Luther sort of went over, and he has an incredible operatic voice to start with. He stood beside one of these men and sang with his big, boomy voice and sort of the guy's arms and part of them. And sang louder as it did, and the gentleman sort of smiled. And we decided that, I guess, Kumbaya is the best thing we should sing in any kind of circumstance. And we started singing it at the end of, not the end of concerts, but at the beginning of concerts quite often at the end. And it's sort of got to be a tradition where we have our reunions every 5 years. The singers always request that we sing Kumbaya. There was a negative thing with chamber singers many years ago, in a sense. Some of you may know I have two children. My daughter's a professional singer, she's 23. My son's a sophomore in college at Bentley. When they were very small, of course, they always got all these grapefruit sales also. They would always get up at 6 o'clock so they could go. And my son was not very helpful, actually. He sort of ran around throwing grapefruit around. And so that was difficult. But as the years went on, he got to be a little older. He said, "You know, you seem to have two sets of children." And I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "You have us, and you have them." And it seems that them come before us. And so he wanted to explain. He said, "Every Tuesday night, you seem to have to go someplace with them. And why can't you stay and, you know, do something with us?" And I said, "Well, that's some of my work." And he said, "Well, why can't you call them up and just say that your son wants you to stay home?" And I went, several months trying to explain I had to go on Tuesday nights. And it wasn't until my son was home from school a few months ago, and he said, "You know, I used to give you a hard time about that. I really understood your dedication to your work, but we did feel sort of jealous the fact that no matter rain or shine, every Tuesday night you could go to see them, you know, and no matter what I did or cried or anything else, you left us behind." And because he's 19 years old now, so he said, I really do understand. No, I didn't. That means I do appreciate the fact that you cared about your other them to go every Tuesday night. At the time, I just didn't have the wisdom to go out and handle the other and say, I got to go to work. So all the other thems have been many, many chamber singers, and I think at this point, they've all sort of become one in a greater sense of things. I hope that you all continue to have music a part of your lives, whatever form it may be. Chamber singers, that will be whatever it will be in the future, and that is really dependent upon the teacher, obviously. Some things are intended to go on, and sometimes things are not intended to go on. The only thing I would suggest, and I did say this to Rosine, new administrations take over, new trim the tree, there's pruning that does take place. But like a great singer once told me, when you do prune the tree, you never cut the roots. And so I assume that this tree will continue to grow in whatever direction, shape, and bear whatever fruit is intended. I thank you. That's all I can say. In terms of more realistic things physically, we have to get packed. And as I unpack the trunk, it appears that I will have room for the grilled skirts and cummerbunds. So if you bring them by 3:38, sometime in the next half hour, I'll take those off your drawer next year. In terms of bedroom,